So how did you get into town from Cashel Street, from your house at Cashel Street?
We just walked.
Just walked. Why did you decide to walk instead of taking a bike?
Well, Caroline was with us, and she didn't have a bike, so we all three of us walked together. And, like, there was so much liquefaction and that kind of stuff that we decided just maybe walking might have been easier, and... It actually, I'm glad we did walk, because it would have been kind of too chaotic to try to put our bike somewhere and this and that. Like, we probably just, because people were just trying to frantically get home, so if we maybe left our bikes there, then who knows if they would have been there.
Yeah.
But definitely the people, they did take the bike to get home safely, but yeah, we just walked.
I heard a story of a woman who ran in her stocking feet from, I think it was from the central city to Papanui, which is, what, 6-7 kilometers to go to make sure her child was all right.
Yeah.
So I wouldn't be surprised either if someone grabbed her bike.
Well, exactly. Yeah. So.
Mm-hmm. So Caroline came in as well.
She came also just because, you know, we wanted to obviously make sure that everyone at the house knew where we were going and stuff. So, and Caroline figured she'd come along too to see if she could help. She ended up not staying for the first aid part just because she doesn't have first aid training, but she came down with us just
to see if there was anything else she could do.
And they basically said, no thanks?
Yeah.
At that point, I think it was a little too early for, like, I mean, there was, you know, so much that volunteer work that could have been done after, like, but at that point, they were just really focusing on
rescuing.
You know, exactly, just getting as many people out as they can and treating injuries, and that was pretty much it. Because later on, the three of us, Caroline and the two of us, ended up helping with other non-first aid related stuff, shoveling the silt and stuff.
And part of the student volunteer.
That was a little later on. So.
Oh, yeah, I want to ask you about that in a minute, because I think that what you did with that was amazing. But can I ask you a little bit more about what happened, like, in the immediate aftermath of the quake? So you got there to Latimer Square like half an hour, roughly.
Yeah.
So that means you would have left Cashel Street fairly quickly.
Yeah.
Because it's only a 20-minute walk or something like that.
Yeah.
Was there anything around the around your house at Cashel Street that...
Our neighbor, they had a ton of liquefaction coming up right from, in, like, the front yard. But our house there was some cracks and the walls and stuff, but nothing too dramatic. And
yeah, within like 30 seconds, the neighbor's house was, like, there was water all over the whole front yard and running onto the street. It didn't take long.
Wow.
And then the neighbors across from us too had damage to the house.
Yeah.
They had like
one wall
collapsed, and it was the bedroom wall, so you could see right into the bedroom, and some other things too, like nothing. Well, the one building that collapsed on Cashel Street, that was one that was already blocked off from the previous earthquake, and it's good that it was, because it ended up completely collapsing.
So that's not the CTV, but...
No, it was just a smaller little two-story building.
Yeah.
Is that the red brick building just a block away?
Exactly, yeah.
The little house.
Exactly, yeah. And it's good that they had it blocked off, because it completely fell onto the sidewalk, and, you know, if they didn't have that fencing around it, you know, there could have been someone...
Under there.
One of our housemates was actually biking by that when it collapsed. So that gave
really?
Her quite a startle.
Mm-hmm. Who was that?
The French couple, the
Aurelien or Marie Jeanne.
The girl's name is
Marie Jeanne.
Marie Jeanne.
So she was cycling right past that when
she
it fell down. Oh my goodness! And suddenly,
the earthquake happened, and the bike's like, she got off her bike, she was right by that building, and it completely collapsed.
Oh my goodness!
So she, as soon as that finished, she was right at the house fairly quickly, and she was like, "Buildings are collapsing!" Like, she was very freaked out.
As you would be, yeah. Mm-hmm. So she was the fourth person in the house that you related to?
No, fifth.
Oh yeah,
us
yeah.
Two,
there were
Caroline,
four. She was
Jay.
Jay as well.
And then she came minutes after.
Yeah.
And then it was a while till we saw the rest.
Yeah.
So
again, the three of us know exactly what liquefaction is, but for people who haven't experienced an earthquake in a liquefaction prone area, can you tell them what it is?
well, to be honest, I don't know exactly what it is, but I know that like when the earthquake occurs and the ground is shifting, I guess like it's the layer, yeah, like the layer of earth where there's a lot of moisture in it, it gets pushed up and carries all the silt with it. So there's water that's coming out of cracks in the ground all over the place, mm-hmm. and as it rises, it picks up the silt. And to be honest, I'm not sure why it happens, why it rises, but it can. I mean, in some houses, there were like two foot layers of silt just covering the whole.
And the worst part of it is a lot of sewage pipes did break, so then the liquefaction got contaminated with sewage, raw sewage. So that added a great smell to it.
And that was the stuff that not long after, a few days later, you were shoveling up around the city. Yeah. Wow. On the day when you went to the first aid center, why did you think to go into town as opposed to, how did you know that's where the damage was? Because you were right.
We were figuring tall buildings with bricks.
Right.
Bricks fall, that could hurt people. Like, that's kind of all we were.
Yeah.
We weren't expecting to see entire buildings collapse.
Collapse buildings, but we were thinking people would be injured from the falling bricks. And so that's kind of what drew us there.
Yeah. And how long did you end up staying there?
Couple hours,
three,
I guess.
4 hours?
Yeah, I guess it was a little longer.
Yeah, it went by quick,
but yeah, I guess you're right. It was longer.
Probably about 3-4 hours.
And then you went home because?
We went home just because the minor injuries pretty much stopped coming in, and the major stuff was still going on, and they're kind of reorganizing the triage area, and where they didn't need a minor injury station anymore. So really, we weren't needed anymore.
But yeah,
so
for the last little while, we weren't really doing anything
much
at that point. So.
So yeah, so we, took our first aid kit back and walked home.
Wow.
So yeah.
How many people did you help? Do you think? Roughly.
Not.
Well, you treated probably like 3 minor injuries, I think. And
yeah.
I treated 2 or 3 as well.
Yeah, it wasn't too many. Just because I think a lot of people that had minor injuries just thought,
sort of,
I'll just deal with it when I'm getting home. When I get home, I'll just a little cut. But yeah, we didn't have too many, but the ones we did have, we had to a lot of cleaning was involved just because there was a lot of dirt and that kind of stuff in there. So it was nice though, because with the minor injuries we did have, we could actually spend quite a bit of time fixing them up and making sure that it was properly cleaned, knowing that they're clearly not going to be going to the hospital anytime soon.
Mm.
So.
Are we dealing with the element of shock as well?
Yes, definitely. And that's another thing too, is the people that did come asking, people that were first aid trained, being like, what can I do? We just gave them some gloves, being like, you know what, go into the crowds and try to find people that are shocked, and try to help them out and just give hugs and talk to them and kind of sit them down and get them kind of regrouped, because that was a major thing. But we were dealing with more like the cuts, and people in the crowd were dealing with shock.
Right. So the people that you helped with cuts weren't in shock so much?
Not really, actually.
Bad. They were all pretty good. So the one woman I did help, she just sat by the truck that we were kind of based out of and just sat there, and she had epilepsy and was just scared that it was just going to come on. And I don't know where she was at the time, but you could tell she was in shock. So we just kind of gave her a bit of food and water, and she just sat there, and the other woman was just giving her some hugs every once in a while. And so yeah, it was just, everyone was just kind of pulling together and helping out. So, yeah.
Wow. And are you aware of, in terms of the buildings falling on people, or bits of buildings falling on people, by the time you got in there, were civilians trying to still pull people out of things, or have they all been sort of asked to leave?
I think people were getting asked to leave at that point.
They
weren't letting people in it anymore. So if you're in Latimer Square, you couldn't go in anymore, and there's just constantly people coming out. Now, whether there were still rescue efforts going on somewhere else, I have no idea, but yeah, there was...
I think they were pretty quick to get most of the people out of the central central city.
Yeah.
So
knowing
my guess is, yeah, most of them were either out or on their way out.
Yeah.
At that point.
I suppose the professionals would have replaced the
exactly.
civilians pretty quickly.
Yeah. Yeah.